Today's session, we are going to discuss about Nursing Theories Made Easy Part 3, that is regarding the classification and characteristics. So the learning objectives of today's session are, number one, to study in detail about the classification or about the level of theories, which will be discussed under three headings, based on the scope of theories, based on the functions of theories and the philosophical underpinnings. And the second objective is to help us to be clear about what are the characteristics of theories. So I will be discussing about the seven characteristics of theories. So first on the classification of theories. So classification of theories, as we discussed earlier, it can be discussed under the heading scope, function and philosophical underpinnings. So scope is, it's otherwise called as the scope of generalizability. How far we can extend a specific theory. How far we can apply this theory to large number of people. Based on that generalizability, we have classified this theory. So this theory is being classified as meta theory, grand theory, middle range theory, practice theory and partial theory. So based on the scope, we can understand that there are five classifications based on the generalizability. So we'll discuss about each type of theory in detail. Now, when I say that it is from partial to meta theory, we should understand that the less abstract theory is the partial theory. Whereas as the ladder is going up, this meta theory is considered to be as the most abstract theory. So we know abstract means it is a little bit vague or it is a little bit unclear. So based on that a point of abstractness, we have this classification of theory. So let us start number one with meta theory. So when we discuss about meta theory, we have to remember at least two important points in meta theory. So what is a meta theory? Meta theory refers to a theory about a theory. That is, this theory is discussing about how a nursing theory should be. This theory is going to discuss about how the theory should be developed. What are the processes in development of a particular theory? See, this is the highest level of theory. This theory is going to discuss about how a nursing theory should be. When will I call that as a theoretical framework? When will I say that this is only a conceptual model? It is not a theory. So it talks about how a theory should be. It is talking about broader issues like how to generate knowledge, how a theory should be developed. So it is the highest level of abstractness, and that is called as meta theory. So the second classification under the generalizability or scope is grand theory. So what do we mean by grand theory? As the name indicates, we know that it is going to be a grand in the sense like it is going to cover a large areas of issues related to this specific phenomena of nursing. Now, if you're going to see grand theories, they are usually not specific theories. It comprises of relatively abstract concepts that is lacking operational definition. Which means that this theory is going to, as I told you earlier, it is going to cover a large area of issue. So it is not going to be very specific. It will not talk only about a specific population. It will talk about a large area of people or large area of concern. So concepts will be there. These concepts are not very specific. They are abstract concepts. They don't have specific operational definition because the concepts are found to be very abstract. Now, if I'm going to talk about an example, okay, like Newman's theory, Rogers' theory, Leninger's cultural diversity, Parsi's theory of human becoming, Betty Newman's, okay, all these theories, if you're going to see, it comes under the classification of grand theories. So how are these theories developed? Let me tell you, these theories are not developed by research. It is not developed by continuous research. It may be developed by either an insightful appraisal of existing ideas, in the sense like maybe by observation or maybe by seeing, like it is an insight experience which a theorist is getting, looking or considering that these are the important things a nurse should know. These are the important things that should be included in nursing. When you develop it out of insight rather than opposed to an empirical research, the theories which you develop becomes grand theories. Let me make it very simple. The early nurse theorists, if you are going to see, the early nurse theories, they all comes under the classification of grand theories because they talk in a very higher platform. It talks about everything. Now, let us go a little bit into detail to understand what is a grand theory. Now, when I take this concept, consciousness is a concept, okay? This concept is taken from a theory called as Margaret Neumann's, okay? It is help as expanding consciousness. Now, we have two Neumanns in our nurse theories. One is Betty Neumann. Another one is, we have another one famous nurse theorist, that is Margaret Neumann. Margaret Neumann's theory of health as expanding consciousness. So, health as expanding consciousness is one theory. Now, in this theory, if you are going to see, one concept which the theorist is talking about is consciousness. Consciousness is considered to be a grand theory concept. See, consciousness can refer to consciousness of a patient, it can refer to consciousness of any healthcare worker. So, it is not specific to only say cancer patients with cancer. I cannot say that consciousness, this theorist has not talked about only consciousness of say patients with brain injury. Never. It is for everybody. It is a very general concept. It is a very abstract concept. So, based on the concept, based on the propositions, what is there inside the theory, that is what is determining whether this is a grand theory or a middle range theory. Okay. So, this consciousness is coming under a concept of a grand theory concept. Now, let us see under that Margaret Neumann's theory itself, let us see what is her proposition. Okay, so there are two types of propositions in a nursing theory. You have non-relational and relational. We will not go into detail about that. Let us read this proposition. This proposition talks about the same. It is taken from her theory. The evolving pattern of person and environment can be viewed as a process of expanding consciousness. Now, this is a statement given by Neumann that the pattern of a person and an environment is viewed as a process of expanding consciousness. Now, again, this particular statement, if you are going to see about expanding consciousness, is going to be a very abstract and a very general level of a proposition. So, that is why we say that these theories are put under the heading of grand theory. So, meta theory is a theory about a theory. That is how a theory should be. While grand theories are the major, you call that as a major philosophies or what to say, it is talking about a broad range of interests. It is not very specific. It is very abstract. As an example, what we have seen now, consciousness under the theory of health as expanding consciousness according to Margaret Neumann comes under grand theory. The same thing, other theories, Parsi's theory of human becoming or Leninger's theory or Roger's theory of energy field, all these things are applicable in many, many general population as well as it is very broader concept. So, that is why these theories are put under grand theories. Now, let us look on to the next theory, that is our middle range theories. Now, most of the nursing theories now are evolving or it is coming under the classification of what is called as middle range theories. Now, what is the specialty of a middle range theory? Middle range theory, as opposed to a grand theory, it has limited number of concepts, which means it is having a specific number of concepts. It will not take a very large number or it will not talk about very abstract. Compared to a grand theory, middle range theory is having a limited number of concepts. One good thing about a middle range theory is it has operational definitions, which means the concepts are very specific. Not so highly specific, but compared to a grand theory, it is specific. It has operational definitions, which means the theorist would have defined what is the meaning of this particular concept, and there are specific propositions. So, we have already discussed in part 1 and part 2 video the importance of propositions. Propositions, I have told you in part 2 video that proposition is the base for hypothesis. I have told you that theory testing research. In theory testing research, what are we using? We are taking a proposition and we are developing a research from that propositional statement, and you are testing and seeing whether the theory is supported or not supported. So that sort of a theory testing research can be done in this theory, that is called as a middle range theory. Why? Because in middle range theories, there are operational definitions and there are propositions which are given by the researcher. So you can develop a testable hypothesis. Examples of middle range theory we have are Orlando's theory, Watson's theory of caring, the famous Pavlov's theory of interpersonal relationship. All these things comes under middle range theory. Let us see an example. Now, this example is taken from Orlando's theory of deliberative nursing process. Now, compared to a grand theory, please look at this concept. This concept is nurses' activity. See, it's very specific. It's not very specific, but still it is comparatively specific than a grand theory. In grand theory, what did we say? We told about consciousness. Consciousness, I told you, it can be anybody's. It can be patient, it can be nurse, it can be anyone. Whereas look at this concept. This concept in Orlando's theory, she's talking about an activity a little bit specific. What activity it is? Nurse's activity. So that is considered to be a concept of middle range theory. Let us look at one of her relative proposition. In her proposition, Orlando has said, what a nurse says or what a nurse does is necessarily an outcome of her reaction to something in the situation. Now, this statement is taken from Orlando's theory. What is the statement talking about? It is talking about what is the nurse's activity. It is talking about what a nurse is saying or what a nurse is doing. See, it's a bit specific. It is talking at least about nurse's activity and what a nurse is saying or doing. So that is why this propositional statement and this concept is being included under this heading of middle range theories. Now, with this understanding, let us go a little bit more into the next type of theory, that is called as practice theories. Practice theories are little bit more specific compared to a middle range theory. Okay, here if you are going to see, it is more specific. The concepts are little bit more specific. It is least complex. So that is why you call that as practice theories. You can use these theories in the nursing practice, everyday practice, you can use these theories because it is least complex and it is providing a specific directions for practice. It is telling you what to do or how to do or what to say. It is trying to explain about a specific activity of a particular nurse. Now that is why we say that it is narrow in scope, but it is explaining a small aspect of reality. Let me tell you, practice theories cannot be applied for every situations or every phenomena because these are having a narrow. Let us see an example for a practice theory. So the example of a practice theory, if you're going to see infant bonding theories. When we spell out infant bonding theories, even without reading this theory, we all know that this theory is applicable only to the infant who is having or developing a bond or a specific relationship with his or her parents or caregivers. So that is infant bonding. I cannot apply an infant bonding theory to a toddler or to a preschooler. So let us see how specific it is. This can be used in everyday practice. So that is why this infant bonding theory, oncology pain management, how specific it is. It is not talking about just pain. It is talking about oncology pain management, which means it is applicable to management of pain among patients with cancer. So that is why we say that it is very narrow in scope and it is also less complex compared to a grand theory or a middle range theory. And it is limited to a specific population. In other words, we can say that this theory is somewhat like a prescription. It is telling you what to do, how to do, what to expect. So these are, this classification of theories is called as practice theories. The last one under generalizability is partial theories. Partial, as in this flower, we find that only two petals are pink, whereas the other things are still gray in color. Partial theories like this, it is what I say, only some aspects are developed into theory. Whereas some concepts and some relationships are identified, but the theory is not complete. There are certain concepts which are developed by the theorist. There are certain relationships which is being explained by the theorist, but it is not complete. All the concepts and all the relationships or all the propositions have not suited the level of a theory. So that is why we keep these theories as partial theories. So this is classification number one, where we find that we have, based on the scope or generalizability. It's very true, because highly generalizable theory is going to be the grand theory, and the least generalizable theory is going to be this one, that is the practice theory, because it is narrow in scope. Middle range theory is going to lie in between the grand theory and the practice theory. Meta theory is going to be a theory which is telling how a theory should be, how a theory should be developed, and how the knowledge should be generated. And partial theory, as the name indicates, partially it has satisfied the aspects of a nursing theory, but still more, there are certain things that has to be clarified. So this is how we can classify theory, based on the scope or based on the generalizability. Now coming on to the second main level of theory, or second main classification of theory, that is function of nursing theories. Based on the function, we can classify the nursing theories. Let us see how. So based on the function or purpose, we can classify the theories as descriptive theories, explanatory theories, predictive theories, and prescriptive theories. So let me tell you one word. These theories usually are middle range theories. Middle range theories can either be a descriptive theory, explanatory theory, or a predictive theory. So grand theories usually we cannot classify like this, but a middle range theory we can classify. So based on the function, whether it is describing, explaining, predicting, or prescribing. Now we see that there is some other name which is put over there. Descriptive theories are factor isolating theories. Explanatory theories are factor relating theories. Predictive theories are situation relating theories. And prescriptive theories are otherwise called as situation producing theories. So as we read each slide, it will be clear. So the first one is descriptive theories. Descriptive theories are factor isolating theories. As the name indicates, this theory is only going to describe. It is only going to observe and name the concepts, properties, and dimensions. It will not tell that there is a relationship between this concept and that concept. It will just tell you that, okay, these are the various concepts which are there in this particular theory. It will only tell you that the main concepts or the main properties of the concepts only will be told. It will describe the concepts, but it is not explaining how or why the concepts are related. It is not going into detail. It is not telling why this concept and this concept is related, or how this concept and the other concept is related. Let us see an example. The example is our concept analysis, and even our Peplow's theory of interpersonal relationship comes under descriptive theory. In a concept analysis, what are we doing? We are just trying to identify what are the concepts related to a specific phenomena. Let me tell an example. Maybe concept of pain. When I am going to study, or when I am going to write a study in detail and write a paper on concept of pain, I'm going into detail to find out what are the various concepts which comes under this phenomena of pain. But I am not going further. I am only telling, okay, these are the various words that are related to the concept of pain. But I am not going to explain in my research paper why these concepts are related or how these concepts are related. So our famous Peplow's theory is also coming under, it is a middle range descriptive theory. Peplow has told these three phases are there. Peplow has told nurse should take up these particular six roles or seven roles. The nurse has to function like this. But she did not explain exactly why do you think this phase comes before another, or why do you think that this follows the other? What is the relationship between this phase and that phase? So those things were not explained in Peplow's theory, and that is why it comes under the classification of a middle range descriptive theory. In other words, you are isolating. You are isolating the factor. What is the factor? The concept. You are just isolating the various concepts and putting it into light that these are the factors. So factor isolating theory, or it's otherwise called as a descriptive theory. The second one is our explanatory theory. Explanatory theories is going little bit beyond a descriptive theory. There it was factor isolation. Now here we are going to see factor relating theory. So now we understood the key point behind that. Even without reading the slide, we know that, okay, in this theory there are concepts, and this theory is also going to tell us what is the relationship between this concept and the other concept. So this is like, it relates concepts to another, one to another, and it describes the interrelationship between the concepts or between the propositions. Or you have a statement called as proposition, because proposition is the statement which tells the relationship between two or more concepts. So this theory, which is called as explanatory theory, is usually developed by doing a correlational research. We know correlation research, definitely it is going to tell about the relationship between one variable and the other variable. So when you do a correlational research, multiple correlational research, and when you are in a position to explain the relationship between these concepts, the theory which is going to develop is called as an explanatory theory, or in other words, it is called as factor relating theories. The third one is predictive theory. Predictive theory is otherwise called as situation relating theory. So it is not just telling only the relationship, but it is going to predict. It will tell the exact thing. If X plus Y is going to be done, then Z will happen. So that is called as a predictive theory. It is trying to tell. It is trying to predict the relationship between the concepts. It will describe the way in which the change is taking place in a different phenomena. So that is predictive theory. Predictive theory will explain you beautifully why this and this are related, and why how this Z will come when X and Y is going to be related. So I told you a formula, just for an example, X plus Y is equal to Z. Predictive theories can tell you beautifully why X and Y relation can end up with an Z. So that is called as predictive theory. So it is describing how the changes is taking place, and this experimental research. I told you in the previous one, explanatory theories, this theory is developed by correlational research, whereas a predictive theory is developed by an experimental research. Multiple experimental research studies, when you are doing it and when you are going to develop a clear understanding why X plus Y variable ends up with Z, you will be in a position to develop a theory which is going to be a predictive theory. So predictive theories are usually based on experimental research. The famous Orlando's theory of deliberative nursing process comes under predictive theory. We know nursing process, assessment, nursing diagnosis, objective, expected outcome, plan of action, implementation and evaluation. See, this theory is trying to explain that when you are going to do certain specific nursing interventions, after that if you take an evaluation, you can find out whether the previous findings are reduced or not. See, Orlando was a person who has taken a first step in the development of nursing process. How beautifully Orlando has told that if you do a very good assessment, if you come to a proper nursing diagnosis, if you can set up a good objective, then definitely based on your plan, if you do the intervention, your evaluation, most often it will be positive. Now, that is how Orlando has explained her nursing process theory, and that beautiful explanation which was given by Orlando made her theory to come under this list that is called as predictive theory. If you can do an assessment properly, if you can come to a proper nursing diagnosis, situation relating theories. The last one under this function classification is prescriptive theories. Prescriptive theories is otherwise called as situation producing theories. Now, as we know from the word prescriptive, it is going to prescribe nursing care. As we discussed earlier under the practice theories, I told you that it is prescribing. It will tell you specifically what should be done, what are the various protocols you have to do if you want to achieve that particular goal. So it is providing the activities that are necessary in order to reach the defined goal. So they will address what are the nursing therapeutics that should be done, what nursing interventions should be done, and based on that intervention, what will be the consequences of an intervention. So like what to say, for example, it is not a theory, but still I can tell you, like, we can relate this to our weaning protocol of a patient on a mechanical ventilator. How beautifully we have developed a protocol for weaning a patient from a mechanical ventilator. So something similar to that. This theory is similar to that. Like, it gives you a protocol. It gives you an idea what all things should be done if you want to get this particular consequence. So that is why, based on the function, what it does, it comes under the classification of a prescriptive nursing theory. So far we have discussed the main two headings. That is, number one was based on the scope or based on the amount of generalizability. We have seen the classification, that is meta theory, grand theory, middle range theory, practice theory, and partial theory. The second main classification, we try to study theories based on its function. In this, we have seen it is descriptive theory, explanatory theory, predictive theory, and prescriptive theory. One more classification is left out, that is, I have an example for a prescriptive theory. Now, this example is taken from Michel's theory of uncertainty. So, Michel has developed a theory called as theory of uncertainty in 1997. Now, in this theory, Michel has told that increasing the coping skill of patients with gynecological cancer will assist their ability to deal with the uncertainty of the cancer diagnosis and treatment. See, this is a prescribing statement where the theorist believes that if you can develop the coping skill of a patient, that coping skill, if you can develop well, that itself will help them in their ability to deal with the uncertainty of cancer diagnosis and treatment. In other words, it is very simple. It is saying that if you increase the coping level, their ability to handle an uncertainty will become very easy, or it will be better. That is what Michel's theory of uncertainty is telling. Now, since it is telling, like, if you do this, you will get this, it comes under the classification of a prescriptive theory. Let me tell you, under the scope of generalizability, under which heading will this come? It's very specific, gynecological cancer. So it is not a middle range theory, it is a practice theory. So it is a practice theory, which is a prescriptive theory by function. Now let us move on to the third main classification of nursing theory, that is based on the philosophical underpinnings. So this, based on the philosophical underpinnings, this classification is given by Afaf Ibrahim Melis in the year 2011. Hope you remember I have spelt a word of Melis in my part 1 video, where I told that meta paradigm, usually we follow 4, but according to Melis there are 7. Okay, so Melis is a very famous person who has done a lot of work related to nursing theory. So let us see, according to Melis, what are the classification of theory. So Melis has told that based on the philosophical underpinnings, you can classify the theories as need theory, interaction theory, outcome theory, and humanistic theory. It's very simple. Based on what it is doing, based on what is the outcome, okay, or based on what is the theory really dealing with, based on that philosophical underpinning, we have 4 types. So let us see in detail. So the first one is need theory. Need theory, from the name we understand that this theory is going to cater to the need of the patients. So it is based around helping individuals to fulfill their physical and mental needs. Any theory which is talking about fulfilling a need of a patient, it comes under need theory. Now, if you're going to see the example, Abdullah's 21 nursing problems. We know that Abdullah's typology of 21 nursing problems is talking about taking care of the nursing need of the patient. 21 lists what Abdullah has told. Henderson has told about the 14 components. That 14 components is talking about physical needs, psychological needs, spiritual need, and the social need. So the vocational need. So that is, again, Henderson's theory is talking about fulfilling the need of the patient. Coming on to Oram's, Yes, definitely. Oram is talking about meeting the needs of self-care for a patient. So when a theory is going to talk about fulfilling or meeting the need of another individual, it comes under the classification of need theory. But there is one small criticism in need theory, because these theorists, they believe that patient is in an overtly dependent position. Full and full, nurse will be giving care for the patient. If you take Abdullah's or Henderson's or Oram's, nowhere you say that patient is taking up a goal setting. No, no. It is always the nurse who is going to take care of the need of the patient. So that is why this is a small criticism for a need theory. That is, patients are usually in a dependent position. The second one is interaction theory. So we know that this theory is going to give importance for the relationship the nurse is forming with the patient. They give more importance to interacting. How we form a relationship with the patient, or how a nurse is going to get into a therapeutic relationship with a caregiver. That is called as interaction theory. We have so many theories which comes under interaction theory. Our famous Imogen and King's theory, it gives importance to interaction. Orlando's nursing process theory, Peplow's theory, Travelby, Wiedenberg, everybody. So many theories can be put under interaction theory. Very simple. As the name indicates, this theory gives importance to interaction which we form with another individual, usually the patient. The third classification under this heading is outcome theory. Outcome theory, here this theory portrays nurse as the changing force by giving direct patient care, who enables the individuals to adapt to ill health or cope the ill health. That is, this theory, they give importance to the nurse is going to be the changing force. It is not only meeting the need of a patient, but helping the patient to adapt, helping the patient to cope up with the illness or health. That is what is making the difference between a need theory and an outcome theory. Need theory full and full talks about meeting the need, whereas outcome theory is giving more importance to help an individual to adapt to an ill health, or help the patient to cope up with the ill health. So who is the changing force? Nurse is the changing force. So examples of outcome theories: Johnson's behavioral system theory, Mirai Estrin-Levin's conservational theory, Roy's adaptation model. All these theories, they talks about how to conserve the integrity of a patient, how to help a person to modify his or her behavior, how to help a patient to adapt to a particular situation. So that is why these theories are put under the classification of outcome theory. Okay, the last classification under philosophical underpinnings are humanistic theories. Humanistic theory is a very high level theory. This emphasizes a person's capacity for self-actualization. See, that is what makes the difference. Here, we believe, or these theorists believe, that person has the capacity. Who is this person? The patient. The patient has the capacity for self-actualization and believes that a person contains within himself the potential for a healthy and a creative growth. Nurse is only going to be just to inspire the patient. Nurse is only there to help a person to identify his or her strength. Nurse is not the complete changing force, because these theorists, they believe that patient has certain potential. Shall I give you one example? The best example is Rogers' theory of unitary human beings. If you're going to read Rogers' theory, it's such a beautiful theory, where Roger highly believed that this patient, or this particular person whom you're dealing with, is having a lot of potential. It is not only that a nurse is having, you just have to be a person in the environment trying to improve the energy field of the patient, and that will make a huge difference. So that is why Rogers' theory is put under the classification of humanistic theory. So these are the classification of nursing theories. Mainly you can classify it under three headings. Number one, based on the generalizability. Number two, based on the function. Number three, based on the philosophical underpinnings. For students, this theory question can be asked either as classification of nursing theories, or it can be asked as level of nursing theories. When you are asked a question as what are the level of nursing theories, the answer is the same. Level is also going to be based on the generalizability based on the function and based on the philosophical underpinning. So I believe that this the classification of theories is clear. Now let us move on to the second topic, that is characteristics of nursing theory. I am going to discuss only about 7 characteristics of nursing theories. We all know what is a characteristic. Characteristics means these things should be there, or these are the usual way how these particular phenomenon is exhibited. This is how a nursing theory usually is. That is what we call it as characteristics of theory. So let us see, there are 7 characteristics. Number 1, theories should interrelate concepts in such a way as to create a different way of looking at a particular phenomenon. Now here I have put a picture of a chessboard where you have so many pawns, or the soldiers, the king, the... See, when I see this, even if I'm going to see so many things are being arranged here, I know that this is going to represent a chessboard. Same way, theory should interrelate concepts. Concepts should not stand alone. That is not a theory actually. When this X and Y and Z and A and B and C are there in a theory, it should interrelate it. It should bring this X and Y. It should bring this A and B. Just the beautiful example is Oram's theory. You take, already I have told you this, self-care agency, therapeutic self-care demand. How Oram is pulling each and every concept, and she is trying to relate it in such a way that she is projecting in different phenomena called as theory of self-care. Various concepts are being interlinked. Various concepts are being interrelated, and she comes out with a beautiful way of looking at a specific phenomena. The second characteristic of a good theory is the theory should be logical in nature. Logical, when we spell the word logical, it is usually logical reasoning. That is, a theory should be developed either by an inductive reasoning or it should be developed by a deductive reasoning. So in part 2 video, we have discussed in detail what is an inductive reasoning and what is a deductive reasoning. A good theory is like that. It is developed by a logical reasoning, inductive or deductive. Then a famous theorist called as Fawcett. Fawcett in her textbook has told that logical reasoning can either be inductive, deductive, or it can also be retrodective. So these are the 3 ways by which we can develop a theory. A good theory is usually logical in nature. The third characteristics of theory is generalizable. So far we have seen that theory is generating, or it is being generalizable to a large group of people, or at least to a small group of people. Even in our practice theories, for the example, we saw that gynecological cancer patients. So for all patients with gynecological cancer, this theory is generalizable, or it can be applicable to a larger group of population, like what we saw in a grand theory or middle range theory. Whatever may be the result, the final is this: a theory is not specific only for this particular people. It should be generalizable to all people with that particular condition. So that is the third characteristics of a theory. Number 4. The fourth characteristic is theory is usually the base for hypothesis that can be tested. A good theory. So this theory, we know that this theory, a very good characteristic of this theory will be applicable to middle range theories. Because in middle range theories, we have very good concrete operational definitions are there, and from that you can develop the propositions are there, and from that proposition you can develop a hypothesis which can be tested. So that is another good characteristic of a theory. Number 5, a theory will increase the general body of knowledge within the discipline through the research implemented to validate that. So theory is actually generating knowledge, no doubt in that. But we have studied in part 2 video, theory, practice, research, everything is interrelated. So theory should improve the knowledge, and this theory should be validated. It should be tested and seen whether it is right or not by doing research. So that is another one. Characteristics of a theory, it will increase the general body of knowledge by research implemented to validate them. The sixth characteristic of a theory, theories are used by practitioners to guide their practice and to improve their practice. That is the base of a theory. Theory can be used for research purpose. Theory should be used in nursing practice. The last characteristic, a good theory is consistent with other validated theories, but always it will leave unanswered questions that needs to be investigated. If you take any type of theory, for example, if you are going to take this Levin's theory of conservational integrity, this theory is found to be in par, or it is found to be somewhat similar to theories that have been developed in humanities and in science. So, which means the theories is not that it is always against from somebody else what they have told. It usually gets along with other similar theories, and a good theory will always leave certain unanswered questions that needs to be answered. So, it's not that everything is being told. There will be certain points which are left incomplete, and that can be taken up by another theorist or another researcher, and it can be followed on. So these are the seven characteristics of nursing theories. So nursing theories, the simple seven characteristics are: number one, it should interrelate concepts. That is the keyword. Number two, logical, inductive, deductive, and sometimes even retrodective, as told by Fawcett. Number three, theories are generalizable. Number four, it is a base for hypothesis. Number five, it increases the general body of knowledge validated by research. Number six, it is used by practitioners to guide nursing practice. And the last one, it is consistent with other validated theories, but there are certain unanswered questions that needs to be investigated. So this is the main crux of today's session. That is, we have seen what are the classification or the level of theories. And number two, we have discussed regarding what are the seven characteristics of a nursing theory. So thank you very much for watching my video. Thanks a lot.